We would be talking about the concept of the photo scale and the types of photographs that can be generated using the concept of aerial photography. So what is aerial photography? We have already talked about in the previous session. Now when we talk about understanding the scale of a photograph that is generated from an aerial photo, what we need to understand is, if this is the camera and this is the ground, and this area is being captured by the camera on the ground. So what happens, ultimately what comes on a photo or the aerial photograph is the distance that I can see on the photograph and the real distance which is given on the ground. The ratio of these two distances would be known as a photo scale. So what we are trying to understand is how much distance is covered in the photograph as compared to how much distance is there on the ground. This ratio is known as the photo scale. Now there is an alternative method to understand the photo scale is photo RF. RF is the representative fraction. And this representative fraction we have already understood in the class on the scales. Now when we have a representative fraction, for example, I say 1:1000, that means 1 centimeter, for example, on map would be equal to 1000 centimeters on ground. So that is the way I try to understand a map RF. So if I want to find out the representative fraction of a photo or an aerial photograph, what I need to have is the measurement of the photograph versus the measurement on the map multiplied by the representative fraction or the original representative fraction as I can see on the ground. So this is another formula that is used to calculate the scale of a photograph. Now, if you have the focal length given and the height of the aircraft, so if I say the aircraft is flying at a height of say 1 kilometer, okay, and the focal length is say 10 centimeters, I can find out the photo scale, and that would be equal to the focal length, that is 10 centimeter, okay, divided by 100 centimeters or 1000. If I convert this kilometers into meters, it would be 1000 meters. Okay, so and then I further convert it into centimeters, so into 100. So that would be the ratio of the photo scale. So I can say it would be 1/10,000. So this is the way we calculate the photo scale. Now, when we have an aerial photograph, what we need to calculate is the height. And there is a very simple method to calculate the height or the ratio. So here is a diagram. The camera here shows the height of the aircraft. So here is where the aircraft is flying. So this is the height of the aircraft from the ground. We denote it by capital H. Now this is the height of the object that we need to determine. And this is small h. So if I want to find the ratio of the height of the aircraft versus the height of the object, I can say it would be proportional to the distance made by the camera versus the distance of the object from the last point of the camera. So this would be R/D. And if I solve this and I want to calculate the height of the object, I can say it would be D into H, capital H by R. So this is how I calculate the height of the object. Now this is one method where you have a single photograph or a single photo. So if I have a single photo, it's very easy for me to calculate the height of the object. But what if there is a parallax? So when there is a parallax, what I try to do is, there are two images that are cast here. So this is the image 1 and this is the image 2. This is the P1 and the P2, the parallaxes. So I would say the differential parallax would be P1 minus P2. So that would be dP. Okay. Then I will calculate the geometric photo base from one photo to another. So this would be the distance from one photo to another. So that would be B1 and B2. So the base or the photo base length would be an average of these two. So it would be B1 plus B2 by 2. And then what I need to find out is the height of the object. So how would I calculate the height of the object? This height of the object would be height of the aircraft multiplied by the differential parallax divided by the photo base and the addition of the differential parallax. So this is the formula we use when there is a parallax. So these are two methods of photo determination. Parallax is usually used when there are two overlapping air photos, and what we try to do is they are usually on the same flight line. So that is the case where we use the parallax. Now the next is the types of photographs. Now under types of photographs, we would first study what is an oblique photo. So there would be three basic categorizations that we would be talking about today. That's the low oblique photo, high oblique photographs, the vertical photographs. Under vertical photographs, we would be talking about a specialization that would be orthophotos. Then we would be talking about some of those combinations that are derived from these photographs. So this is the camera lens. Usually, this is an example of a low oblique photo. So what happens at a low oblique photo is, it's usually at an angle of 30 degrees from the vertical. You have a small area that is covered under a low oblique photograph. So there are some things that you must keep in mind. First of all, the area covered under low oblique is small. The area that is covered under a low oblique would be in the shape of a trapezoid. Thirdly, I can see the point A and point B for the area that is being covered. That means under a low oblique photograph, you cannot see horizon. So no horizon is visible. Then you have, the important thing here is, the picture that is taken under a low oblique photo, since there is, the camera is at a given angle, you would be much more familiar with the picture that is coming up. For example, if I have supposedly a remote here and I am trying to capture a picture directly from above, I would be only able to capture the ups and downs. While if I am taking the picture of this remote from an angle, I would be able to figure out what exactly the feature is. So you have familiarity that can be seen under a low oblique, and this is again a characteristics of high oblique photograph. So under both a low oblique and a high oblique photograph, you would have a familiar view of the terrain that you can see. Under low oblique, the distance and displacement, I cannot say exactly what it is, or there would be distortions. Okay. Now let's move on to high oblique. So this is something which is high oblique. So under high oblique, you are covering not a small area but a large area. Again, the area that would be covered on the ground would be in the shape of a trapezoid. In this case, as you can see, this is the angle that you are trying to capture. And I can say this point is one point that is visible, and the last point I cannot say where it is marked. It goes till infinity, and therefore I can say in case of high oblique photographs, you have horizon that is visible. So if you want to locate out the horizon, that is possible under high oblique photographs. High oblique photographs usually tilt around more than 30 degrees. So this, if I take 40 degrees, 60 degrees, it would be a high oblique photograph as compared to 0 to 30 degrees, which fall under low oblique photographs. Then again, in this case, you will have a familiar view of the terrain. Now let's move on to vertical photographs. So as I previously mentioned, under a vertical photograph, you would be capturing the picture directly from above. So what would happen here is, you would have the area that is covered would be somewhat in the square shape itself. So the shape would be maintained first of all. Now the view that you would be getting from above would be unfamiliar. You cannot exactly locate what is there on the ground because all the relief features would appear similar. All three stories buildings would appear at the same height. All five story buildings would appear at the same height. It would be very hard to demarcate individual features under a vertical photograph. So under this is a vertical photograph. The line that drops on vertically is known as the plumb line. And this is the area that is covered in case of the vertical photograph. Now, vertical photograph, as I said, it is perpendicular. So a very, very small area is covered as in contrast to the low oblique and the high oblique photographs. Now, orthophoto is a modification, or I could say enhancement of a vertical photograph, which is used mainly in a digital elevation model, and it simulates the 3D landscapes. So you can have a wide variety of 3D landscapes that use orthophotos. It is mainly used by Google Maps and OpenStreetMaps. So this is an enhancement in the field of vertical photography. Orthophotos are usually captured by unmanned aerial vehicles, and these usually have a roll stabilized camera. So you have a roll stabilized camera which lie in an unmanned aerial vehicle, and this is used to capture vertically the picture of the ground. It's perpendicular to the nadir, and there is very less distortions that can be seen under orthophotographs. Besides orthophotographs, there are some other terms that we would be talking about today. These terms are commonly used in most of the cameras that you use today. First is panorama. So panoramic view is a view where you try to capture a huge set of area. So if I am taking an aerial photograph and I want to capture an area which is much more than what can be captured into a single figure, I call it panoramic view, and this is usually done by stitching various photographs together. So these are the three photographs of the ground that I have taken, and what I am trying to do is I am trying to stitch these photos together. As a result, the photo that would be generated would be a single photo that would cover the complete area. So that is panoramic view. The next is mosaics. These are assemblage of the overprinted images. So what I am trying to do is, I am trying to assemble one and more than one images and then I am trying to generate a photograph. So that is known as mosaics. The next is trimetric one. And the trimetric one, what I do is I have one vertical photo and two high oblique photographs. What I am trying to do is I am trying to create a resultant photo from this one vertical and two high oblique photographs, and that resultant photograph would be a trimetropon photograph. So these are some of the variants that we usually talk about in aerial photography. In the next class, we would be talking about the films and the various displacements and the distortions that occur in an aerial photography. You can subscribe to example.